but it really is a problem. And I think you're actually talking to that into InfoComm. Should we switch over to start talking about?
That is a great segue. So hey. I'm fortunate that I have two panels that I'm happy that I'm able to host. And I know that you have two as well. And so I'm going to turn the tables here and interview the interviewer and
ask him about his. Okay.
Yeah. You got yours. Perfect. So one of the things that I think you have become really well known for, David, is your tricks, your tips, your magic you create in the live streaming world. I mean, a lot of people know you from what you do here with LDV, but I know you also from what you've done with your music interest on Twitch, and you've got a great channel there with playing guitar riffs, flying across, you know, stages on top of billboards. I love it. This is one of your passion projects, right?
It's true. And it actually, I think of it as my sandbox, because when I come up with something that I use, I've been using this in webinars. I say, let's make our webinars more exciting. This poor woman, she's stuck having to watch us. She's going to alt tab. She's going to check her email. If we don't say something funny quick, we got to get interesting, or just, you know, just a gimmick, you know, we're getting famous. We're up on the scenes. But the way I come up with these are from my guitar stream. And I got to tell you something, this is so embarrassing. I've been working with multi-streaming. So I've been using the Restream app. So when I do my guitar stream, I send OBS to the Restream app, and it sends it to Twitch and to my guitar stream YouTube. Mm-hmm. I have a separate YouTube. Okay. And when I'm doing my live stream with Tim that we do here in the boardroom, I send it to Restream, and it sends it to LinkedIn and my Let's Do Video YouTube.
Yeah.
And I forgot to switch it. So I stream for myself playing guitar, dancing around, flying on the back of dragons for an hour and a half last night.
I saw that. I forgot. I did see that. I was checking out what you had going on. I forgot about
that. No one saw that. Everyone saw that.
Did you get some good comments? Did you get some good feedback on that one?
I got like people liked it. I'm like, no, don't like it. I deleted it this morning. I was so embarrassed.
But so. What are you going to share here? You're going to talk about how some of these tools and techniques can work in what we're doing in the AV and the UC space?
Yeah, I've been pushing this for a while because it's so much fun. I love what we're doing here right now. And there has been some pushback. Some people say it doesn't look professional, it's not cartoony. But I think because, you know, they're comparing it to Hollywood stuff that costs hundreds of thousands of dollars. I mean, you need to be comparing this to a phone call or to a, you know, nothing against Zoom and Teams, but to a regular Zoom meeting. I think there's some value here. Some people say, oh, I don't like the way you have the boardroom table. It looks like you're little kids. Our colors don't exactly match because we don't have the same lighting. People have been pushing back, but I've been believing. And a couple of years ago, InfoComm Avixa reached out to me to moderate some webinars for their live streaming sessions, their streaming production, video production track.
Okay.
And they've been the best attended, they've been the comments. I need to make a video with myself just smiling as the comments roll by. They've been really, really going well. And they had me do a second year, and that's went amazingly well. So now I'm giving my presentation in person, and I'm just gonna talk for an hour about how easy this is. It really is. Maybe not to do all the tricks, maybe not to go to London and but to get this basically going and to upgrade your videos and how everyone should be doing it. And I'm going to give a little bit of a tutorial. I wish I could kind of bring a laptop that could run OBS and set it up there, but I think it's a little too much task. I'm just going to have a PowerPoint with some video, but I'm going to try to show how I do some of this fun stuff.
I think it's great. I mean, we are there's a part of our DNA that we need to embrace is that we are content creators in the new world of where people absorb a lot of information through either podcast or webcast. It becomes an important part of how we deliver message. And it also is an important part of how people deliver internally. Let's go back to what we talked about. Maybe it's an internal webcast you're doing with your company, employee experience, making people engage and enjoy what the message you're delivering becomes a powerful tool if it's done right. So I think this is going to be a great session. I'm sure it's going to be a standing room only.
Yeah, thank you. It's what is it? Wednesday at 10 a.m. Little hard to see up there.
Exactly.
The second session, and this one, I'm just going to be moderating the panel. Luckily, we have an amazing panel that knows a lot more than me about this. But it is something that I've experienced trouble with recently in my life, which is captioning isn't as easy as it should be. At this point, I would think it's like, look, if you're renting the convention center for your convention, you know there's going to be ramps. You don't worry about that. If I'm using a video solution to do a video, I expect it to be just have captioning. I really did. Yeah. And I had a client recently, actually a friend client, Hillary Scarl. She's a producer, writer, Hollywood person. And she made a play. It's called Not Another Deaf Story. And the cast is entirely deaf. The crew is entirely deaf. It's amazing. It was hugely successful. So now she's kind of making it into a whole thing. And she had me do a live stream, like what we're doing here, but with her stuff. It wasn't in my boardroom, it was in her. And so I learned when you have an interpreter on screen, you ask them to give you the sign for heaven and baby. Because heaven, I don't remember the exact sign, but it's as high as your hands will go, and baby is as low as your hands will go. So if you could see them doing, if they do baby and you don't see them, you got to adjust the camera. So
wow, interesting.
Right, I love that. I don't know why, but I love that. But I also learned as we're doing it, we said, okay, so now when we do this, how are we going to turn on the captioning? I'm like, oh yeah, we'll just turn it on. Where's the captioning button on this thing? And
oh no,
it's an expensive service that costs a lot of money if you want to do it right. Oh, you have to set it up beforehand. Oh, I guess we're not doing it, which was not the right answer, but that was the answer. So hopefully I'm going to learn.
I think that's going to be great. I know it's been a topic coming up about accessibility of this. Again, we are dealing with a lot of virtual environments, and there's no reason that anyone who's got either impairments around hearing, maybe they're neurodiverse or something like that, that would need to have some element of be able to read along as well too, and deal with that as well. So I think that's an important piece, and let alone translation and whatever else in terms of more international business as well. So I think that's it's a great topic. I think it's an important one.
Yeah, and it ties in what we were talking before. If the new, our new office, our new workspace is all virtual, it has to be accessible.
Yeah, and you know what's really interesting? This isn't a pro AV audience, but they're being asked about these things. They are being asked about how can you make this Zoom call more accessible? How can you make this Teams meeting more accessible? My all hands, things like that. And understanding the options and the solutions, I think it's a great bit of information to bring to them.
Yeah, this is our world now. And that's also Wednesday at 1 p.m.
You got a busy Wednesday.
Yeah. Oh my God, I have meetings in between them too. It's going to be great.
And then here's the one I'm leaning with. You were talking about that. Is if you would to zoom out again, let's take a look at that
this
and talk about this.
This is the problem. Let's say we had people in all these chairs.
Yeah.
We have one camera that moves around with voice, but then we lose context of everyone else. We have 12 cameras. That's crazy.
That's a lot. And there's been a lot of development taking place in what's called multi-camera and multi-stream technology taking place right now. And in fact, some of our friends that you and I know from Crestron, Logitech, Neat, and many others are bringing to market with Microsoft Teams and Zoom multi-camera solutions. So this is an opportunity to help these pro AV designers and implementers understand what are the different options when they're asked about multi-cameras and when is the right opportunity to apply them. So let's think of it this way. Crestron, who's there, is going to have what I call it an outside-in solution, multiple cameras potentially on the wall looking in to what that the room is. Logitech and Neat are going to be examples of what I call inside-out, and they have a center-of-table camera, usually paired with a front-of-room camera as well, too. They all across the board have these great universal values, more angles to pick up people, more microphone pickup. Some even bring control down closer to the table. So even if it's a long boardroom, having that camera a little bit further closer to where you and I are on the far end becomes important. Because here's a really interesting thing. When you zoomed out, if I was looking on this video and this was a boardroom, you and I are occupying the seats of probably the two most important people in the room. That's going to be the chairperson or the CEO, the he or her that runs the business. And
the boss.
What do they get? They get the least number of pixels on this whole image right now, right? We're stuck in the back.
I'd rather be in one of those corner chairs closer to the camera.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we're going to demystify that. We're going to find out where are the value adds right now. We're going to find out then what use cases do each one of these solutions work well together. So it's going to be a good conversation.
I'm excited about this one. Just real quick, because this is new. I mean, some of this technology has been around for a while. We've had center table that we tried before. The world wasn't ready. We've had outside camera things that, you know, the AI wasn't there for it yet. But it all works now. You know, the center of tables, we're not laughing at them now. And it's not just one vendor who's trying it as an experiment. There's a lot of top vendors who put a lot of development into them. They're good. The outside in, same thing. It's the new AI. And we analysts, market, no one knows what's the right, if there is a right, is it one of those things where some might go inside out, some might go outside in, or is it in a year one will win over the other? We don't know yet. So I'm dying to know your opinion on all that stuff and the rest of your panel, because this is just happening now.
And these are super smart people. You might know some of the names: Sam Kennedy from Crestron, Nathan Cotino from Logitech, and Norma Lovehagen from Neat. These are people that manage the products or talk to the customers every day. So yeah, and here's the inside scoop: there's no single playbook. What we're going to do is help dissect when and where these solutions probably work best for you. So yeah, I'm excited about this one, because at heart, I'm a device guy. That was my origin story, and I like talking about making devices work in real life situations.
Yeah, there's a related problem. I don't think I have time to go into it today, but maybe you'll have to come back. I'll have to come on your show to talk about it, because it's a related problem that I'm not happy with any of the answers to, which is the fact that not only do the people who are in the meeting room have the worst camera angle, we're missing out because everyone who's at home is talking on the chat. And we're not in on the chat.
Oh, yeah.
Unless we all have our laptops out and all connect. And I think there's some solutions are coming up with like a disconnected mode, a meeting mode that just does the chat. It's just a related conversation that I'd love to have with you at some point.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of interesting solutions. These rooms, they're large rooms as well, but they're also a category of rooms, a subsection I call high impact rooms. These are the boardrooms. These are the town halls. These are the ones that have really high stake meetings taking place. So it's important to see what's going on. And if you're in that room and there's things taking place on chat or something like that, you've got to be part of that to be able to understand what's going on.
For sure. Yeah.
We're trying to create meeting equity for both sides, people in the room, as well as people who have access to multi-monitors in front of them as well. Now, so this session is taking place Tuesday, 1 o'clock, and this is going to be a great one. I hope everyone can show up for that one.
Yeah, I know everyone on the panel. I got to be there. All right. Oh, AI. I'm not tired of talking about AI. I'm not going to get tired. It's not hype. It's all real. I'm in.
Well, I appreciate that. This is actually, I think, good, because we're at a point in time where the rubber hits the road. We're going from proof points to real use cases, I think, in this AI arc of what's taking place. I had a term before, I forgot. It was really well. We're going from proof of concept to proof in the room or something like that. I'll have to remember it. But I have got some really smart people to help talk through how their solutions are talking about how AI is enhancing the meeting room experience and the larger office experience as well, too. I've got some of the major UC platform people represented here. I've got Microsoft, represented by Ilya Buchstein. Zoom is represented by John Stearns. And WebEx is represented by Espen Loberg. I also have Jason Moss from QSIS, who's going to help represent some of the hardware elements that they're bringing into space as well, too. But think about this. All of these platforms have some element of AI built in. How do you take that element of AI and make it accessible to group collaboration experiences? That's one of those ways we're going to talk about that. You and I have Copilot or Ask AI Companion on our laptops, but what's the opportunity to share that within a group collaborative space? And what does it look like? And what does it mean going forward? And I think there's a lot of powerful story there. And then also what you can start thinking about too is all three of those platforms have this great intelligent platform that helps you understand what's going on in the larger office space outside of the meeting room. Zoom has, spaces. WebEx also has spaces, formerly DNA spaces. And Microsoft is in beta with what they call places, about to come out soon. This started with desktop reservations, room reservations, but it's the idea that these are platforms that I can use intelligence to see, hey, is David in the office? Do I want to sit next to David? What's the conditions in the office? Is it crowded? What's available? the ability to communicate in the context of the space. I want to send a note to everyone who's in building three, but not the entire campus, you know, things like this. So there's a lot of interesting use cases we get to try and play through as we talk about AI in the conference room.
That makes me think of one of the presentations we saw at Crestron. I'm so bad at names. I love this guy. I became a fanboy of him. I raved about him in the video I did about him, and I forgot his name. But I'll put a link to my wrap-up of the Crestron event below. But he was talking about some of this kind of stuff, and he was talking about how it was really clever. You might like the seat by the window. And so the desk reservation system, if it's smart enough and realizes that you always sit there, it'll try to schedule it for Tuesdays because those window seats are open. But then if everyone starts scheduling for Tuesdays because of it, and then they're full and you're always sitting away from the window, it's going to think you don't like sitting by the window. So it's going to schedule for other days. You know, it could get the wrong message by you working around it. But ideally, he had a great image of two people sitting a cubicle away from each other, and one was dying of heat and the other one was totally freezing with three blankets on because some people are hot, some people are cold. In the same office, so AI could say, hey, people who run hot, you sit by the air conditioning. People who run cold, you sit by the window. And those are little things, but they're real, and they add up. And you do put 1,000 of them into your, you know, workflow, and you're a happier worker by the end of the day.
It was a great example. That was a great conversation that took place.
It was a great session.
Yeah, so AI, so this is, I think, where we're going to see some really great opportunities to help this audience, again, the pro AV audience, the IT decision makers that are there, to start practically applying AI in their office and meeting spaces. And I think it's my belief that we can help people design great environments that encourage people to come in if that's what they desire, or get the most out of the time they're in there as well, have an enjoyable experience.
Now, there's two things I think about. I mean, there's almost two completely different conversations we could have about this. One could be about like the AI that sort of runs behind the scenes, that, you know, switches cameras and balances our audio, you know, gets rid of our background. The reason you don't see a green screen behind me and I don't see your office is because of A, it's literally AI that's doing that for us. And we already have all these AI things in the meeting room helping us. That's one AI meeting room discussion. The other AI meeting room discussion is, I love the idea of I'm in a Zoom meeting with three people, and there's this fourth person who is my little helper bot. And he has a name. I call him, I wish Ask Jeeves never existed, because Jeeves would be such a perfect name, but it's ruined now. But I would be able to say, you know, Jeeves, I wasn't paying attention the last few minutes. What did Craig say? And Jeeves would send me a secret message saying, this is what Craig said. Or Jeeves, I don't want to forget this. Make sure to remind me tomorrow. And tomorrow, Jeeves will send me an email and remind me. I like the idea of when I can think of AI as a person and talk to it like a person and ask it to help me as a person. So is that part of that? Is that what we're talking about here? We're talking about that kind of AI?
You are. Actually,
I'm going to be in this session. I love it.
We're gonna look at this at two, possibly three different levels. Because it does build upon itself. AI can be approached on different levels. So the way you're talking about, we could build from think of a pyramid. We're going to talk about AI and audio and video. The core ideas of proper framing, great pickup, noise cancellation, sound attenuation taking place. Those technologies are algorithmically trained to do smart things, AI. That next level up from that might be in-room assistance. That might be the idea of in-meeting assistance or in-room assistance taking place. You can then start going even higher to the idea of saying, what does AI look like when it's reactive or actually proactive? It's taking notes for us. It's capturing action items. It might even make a suggestion where we all say, okay, we're going to meet on this again on Thursday. And AI taps on the meeting and says, I'm sorry, but David and Craig already have commitments for Thursday and they can't make it. So there's an opportunity for that. That's one way to look at it, building up on the technology stacks and the experience. We could also talk about, what about AI for end users, AIs for IT administrators, and maybe AI for IT executives that might want to see some high-level information. So you have all this data being collected. How do you use that to inform really good decisions, both in the moment as an end user, as an administrator that has to manage these rooms, to an executive that may have to figure out what's my needs for my office space going forward, real estate decisions, things like that as well too. Another angle we might talk about is personal AI versus group AI. You kind of hit upon that yourself. You might have your personal AI agent there helping you take notes and transcribe. But what happens if we have a group agent? Microsoft just released Copilot for Teams. That is a welcomed AI agent that we all equally have access to. Because before they came out with it, I was talking to some of those executives. One of the weirdest things would be if I sent my AI assistant to this meeting and you sent yours and just our AI assistants were in the meeting, right? And,
yeah,
and there's a there's a cultural subcontext there, which says, David, I was double booked, but your meeting wasn't the important one where I want to come in person. I'm going to send my artificial intelligence to come in my place instead. So I think there's a nuance. You got to make sure that you don't abuse this great technology. But having a collectively group-owned AI agent, a Teams agent, for example, is a great way to solve that. You and I have equal access to it, equal access to the notes, equal access to the task we ask it. So I think this is the angle I think we're going to take. My goal is I'm going to give a framework for people how to think about AI in the office, and we're going to probably slice it in these three different ways. These panels are going to talk about practical examples of what AI can look like in the implementation as we look at these different frameworks.
You know, what's exciting to me is how far along that path we are. You know, it seems like, you know, the first step is the sort of AI noise reduction and AI video background reduction, and then getting AI to be able to do meeting summaries, and then getting to the point where the AI is actually sort of like a team member that we can all talk to, like what you were just saying.
Right.
And we're
right.
kind of almost, I mean, they're releasing it. We're kind of almost there. And the basic stuff we are so good at. I was with Dave Michaels. We were playing around testing noise reduction on WebEx, Zoom, and Teams. Bottom line, they're all really, really good. And the line that I started using in presentations, a funny line, is over the last year, and this is true, over the last year, there's been about 15 to 20 times that someone in a Zoom, Teams, WebEx meeting has said to me, "Oh, I'm so sorry about that dog. It won't start barking." There's been zero times that I actually got to hear the dog.
Right, right, right.
So we're there.
We've come a long way. I remember actually, again, in my product executive days when I was on the other side, we used to do the potato chip bag example for people,
yeah,
just to kind of make them believe that it worked because they could physically see
it was shocking.
Something that should be making noise and it wasn't. But and the application started then, but it's gotten so much better. You know, it's called attenuation, which kind of dampens out background noise and does it. There's auto mute, which if I'm not speaking, automatically knows to clip and stop on and off, underlying the technology. And it gets better and better. It's like down to frame level decisions, you know, frame by frame, as if you're in video, of when to cut in audio and cut it out. So it's great technology, and it's easy to consume. AI in that example is a win when you and I don't know the technology is taking place. That is when AI wins.
With Zoom, you actually have to know to turn it off. If I wanted to play music for you now, there's a music button to music mode that turns off the noise suppression. So it's not a matter of users need to know how to turn on the no. It's just how it works, and you have to know how to turn it off. We're beyond there, and that makes me feel like we're ready for the next step. I don't feel like this Copilot AI assistant stuff is hype. I really think it's what they say it is, and it's going to be able to help us.
Yep. I think we're getting to some really good examples here of real life practical applications, and I'm excited about it. It's going to be a great conversation.
All right. So let's wrap this up. People will be able to, people could always find you on LinkedIn. We'll be able to see you at InfoComm doing the rounds, probably with a camera and microphone in hand.
We'll
want to give you credit. I've been loving your content lately. You've been putting out a lot of videos, all the events you cover. You're making sure to bring in the content, and it's just been great seeing it on LinkedIn. And I'm looking forward to going under the new brand.
I love it. I actually just came back from Zoom that had a short event. So there's some videos that are starting to come out right now. But InfoComm is going to be a treasure trove. There's some new product announcements. There's some old friends to catch up with that I'm excited about. There's going to be a lot of great stuff to do that as well, too. And we're going to be in the lights and sounds of Las Vegas.
Yes.
What's going to be crazier than a bunch of pro AV geeks, myself included, running around Las Vegas talking about LED lights and sound and everything?
We'll have to do another video afterwards to wrap it up.
Oh, I'm telling you, it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm looking forward to it. We'll have to... definitely. It's just such a high energy event. You just need three or four days to decompress after that. Oh, it's going to be great. Yes, I'm loving it.
Well, Well, thanks everyone for watching. Thanks, Craig, for stopping by. We will have to, this was, I feel like I wish we had another hour, but we do got to get going. But this was awesome.
We got some other topics we can cover, and we can always collaborate collectively.
Thanks again. Take care.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.